good to be in worship this morning. Welcome on this gorgeous, beautiful day. We welcome those of you that are here regularly and also those of you that are visiting with us. So please be sure to join us for a time of coffee hour and fellowship time after the worship service down in the comments. There are several announcements that you'll read in your bulletin. I just want to highlight one. Last week's community-wide ELC worship was awesome, I heard, and it was really fantastic. It could not have been done without a couple of other great folks. So be sure if you run into our organist, Cheryl, or Polly and Steve Christensen, or Dean Colby, or John Lincoln, that you let them know thank you, and the fellowship committee, because they really made that possible with getting chairs out there, getting things set up, and making sure that we have things sort of pop up. So we hope not to wait another 15 years before we do a community-wide service like that, because it was really lovely and great, and a great big worship together. A few other announcements. Please keep Nancy and Lindsay in your prayers. They're on their way back from Illinois today. Her mother passed away this week, and her funeral was yesterday. So please keep Nancy and Mark in your prayers. Hans Miller has been moved to Pioneer Center, so please keep Hans in your prayers as well. When I pulled in this morning, there was a trailer, and there were kids everywhere, and I thought, do we have a mission trip? What's going on? It was the Boy Scouts. They're headed up to Rhinelander for camping for the week. I knew it once I saw Wall standing out there in his Boy Scout uniform. And so please keep the Boy Scouts in your prayers, because they have a really great camping this week as well. Let us continue to worship God. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, full of compassion and mercy, abounding in steadfast love.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. Eternal God, our Creator, in you
we live, move, and have our being. Look upon us, your children, the work of your hands. Forgive us all our offenses, and cleanse us from proud thoughts and empty desires. By your grace, draw us near to you, our refuge and our strength. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Friends, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit given to us. In the mercy of Almighty God, Christ died for us while we were sinners. And for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Thank you.
love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Today's lesson is from Romans chapter 5. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, but perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We read Psalm 100 responsibly. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with a song.
Know that the Lord is God, our Maker to whom we belong. We are God's people and sheep of God's pastures.
Enter the gates of the Lord with thanksgiving and the courts with praise. Give thanks and bless God's holy name.
Good indeed is the Lord, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from age to age.
As you may have noticed, we're doing a different study. So the way that we'll learn the new Alleluia is that Cheryl will play through it once so our ears can hear, and then Jean will sing it once, and then we'll all sing together. So you can stay seated until that third time when we're all going to sing together. Into the harvest. Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples.
and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus. Simon, the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us train our hearts in prayer. Most holy God, we pray for our words, those which we speak, and those which remain in our hearts. May our word be true and faithful to your word, who is Jesus Christ. There's a church in Kalamazoo, Michigan. There really is in Kalamazoo. That I occasionally preached at as pulpit supply when I served in Kalamazoo as a hospital chaplain. It looked like most churches. There was a grand entryway. There were coffee pots available. There were pews in the sanctuary. But it had one very distinctive feature. Above every door, as you left the church, each door in the sanctuary and each exit to the building was a sign that read, "You are now entering your mission field." It was a pointed reminder that being the church is not simply about showing up for worship on Sunday mornings. Being the church is about living that out in the world. Of our passages this morning, verse 36 of the Gospel is what stands out most to me. When he saw the crowds, Jesus had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus has compassion on the crowds because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. The state of the crowd stirs up in Jesus compassion. And so he walks from city to village, teaching in the synagogues and proclaiming the good news of God's love and curing every disease and every sickness. In doing so, Jesus turns that compassion that he has, his care for the people, into love in action. It's not enough for Jesus to be going alone either. He says he needs more laborers. And so he sends out the disciples. He summons them to him and then gives them the same power, the same authority Jesus himself has to heal and to cast out demons. He tells them to go and proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. He tells them to cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. It's like the very first mission statement of the church. We, the disciples of Jesus Christ, are given power and called to go out into the world to proclaim the good news, cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, and cast out demons. That's a pretty big mission statement. The statement we often live out sounds a little more like, well, it's a little more mild. We, the disciples of Jesus Christ, are who show up at the church building now and then, try not to gossip too much, and definitely don't miss Christmas or Easter. But go out, pray. proclaim the good news, cure people, that's a little much. But that is Jesus' distinct call for us. Probably because he knows people so deeply need to know God loves us and to know that others love us as well. It's when we leave here that we are entering our mission field, the world that so desperately needs to know what it means to be loved and cared for. Remember a few weeks ago when I said that I had preached a sermon early on about the idea that God won't ever give us something we can't handle, being a big fat lie? Well, I looked that sermon up, and it happened to be this very passage about Jesus sending the disciples out because he knew how much people needed to hear the good news of God and to have help in all that they go through with one another. God only gives us as much as we can handle. That's garbage, you know. It's myth, gossip, and rumor. It's not scriptural, it's not theological. Martin Luther did not say this. Ministers won't or shouldn't repeat it, and it certainly didn't come from God Almighty. Because in everything, we need God, and we need one another. That's why it is so important that Jesus sends the disciples out into the world, because some people are harassed and helpless. Sometimes it's even ourselves. Of course we're pretty independent. We have grit and gumption and self-sufficiency. And most of us have a good dose of privilege. But we get through nothing on our very own. God never lets us handle things by ourselves because our Holy Parent is right there with us in each trial. And God places support in others to carry us through. We have plenty of junk that heads our way that we cannot handle on our own. But the good news is we don't have to handle that on our own. God is always there. And our brothers and sisters in Christ are there too. We need to be reminded of this and reminded of our call to live that out outside these walls. Sometimes we get too wrapped up in our own lives, in our own worries, and we miss the opportunity to have compassion on those around us. Look at how Jesus sends out the disciples. He intends very much for them to be in full reliance on God and on one another. He sends them out in pairs. In the passage this morning, it clarifies that they are to help others without getting anything in return. It's complete grace. He sends them out without expecting payment, without backpacks full of supplies, without money, and he says, go, follow my example, but don't take anything with you except one another. Depend on me and depend on your neighbor. We, Jesus' disciples, 2,000 years later, are called to do the same. Rely on God and rely on one another. Sometimes that's hard for us, to depend on others, especially when our pantries are fully stocked. When's the last time you borrowed a cup of sugar from your neighbor? And our bills are mostly paid. We can pat ourselves on the back that somehow what we have done and who we are is from our own logical plan. We went to high school, college, we got a career. We're just flat out pretty well off. We're not being flogged or persecuted for our faith. On a day-to-day basis, most of us have a good sense that we can make it on our own. But then, something changes. A test result comes back positive. An argument with your spouse ends with the word divorce and a question mark in the air.
a change in company structure eliminates a job. There's a car crash, a fire, a move, a death, a phone call in the middle of the night, whatever. And suddenly, you are faced with something you thought only could happen to someone else. And what do? You pray. You call on God. All the stuff that you've accumulated around you can't help you a bit. But God can. In the midst of your whatever, you understand in a whole new way that we are indeed utterly dependent upon God. It kind of takes disaster sometimes for us to remember that, even though God never forgets. Even on the days when we're simply being washed along in the flood of the daily grind, pretty sure we've got enough strength to get us through another day, we are still not living on our own air, but on the very breath, the very spirit, the very ruha of God. The truth is, even on the most normal, ordinary day, we still aren't living on our own time, but on the watch of God Almighty. And sometimes it takes something huge for us to remember we need one another as well. That is why Jesus sends the disciples out to help one another, but also to be light and hope and healing for those in the world who are harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. There are plenty of folks who are feeling helpless these days. There are plenty who are feeling lonely and distraught, as though no one cares. Imagine if each person had a group of people to go where it wasn't awkward to ask for help and support, where people care so deeply for one another and are so unified in their love for God that depending on one another was simply part of what we did. Who doesn't need that? Jesus gives us, in this passage, a vision of what it means to have this kind of community, this kind of compassion and love in action. There's an old sermon illustration that captures this idea of compassion and care for one another. I've had to update it a little. A mother was waiting for her son to walk home from school, and he was late, and she was starting to get worried. And when he finally walks in the door, he says to his mom, "I'm sorry I'm late, but on my way home from school, I saw the neighbor boy, and his bike was broken. So I stopped to help." "What on earth could you do?" exclaimed the mother. "You don't know anything about fixing a broken bike."
"No,"
the boy replied.
"No.
I helped by sitting down with him and crying with him." How many of us have appreciated those dear friends who have sat with us in the middle of difficulties and been compassionate listeners, someone who has shared our tears? These days, there are plenty of people on whom we can look with compassion. The Philando Castiles of the world who fear for their lives because of the color of their skin. People who are part of LGBTQ communities who wonder if they too will experience the violence like the victims in the Pulse nightclub. People who are seeking meaningful work. People who are seeking simply a safe place to live. Those who are broken, sick, and in desperate need of the good news of the kingdom of God's love. And that there are people by their side that will help get them through whatever it is so that they know they are not alone. Our God of love has compassion on just such people. And therefore, we too are sent out like Jesus sends out the disciples, to share that good news, to be healing and wholeness for others. This summer, the lectionary passages point again and again to the ways that we are called out into the world. Not only here to worship God, but to proclaim God's love and God's healing, sent out. Reminded that when you leave this place, you are entering your mission field. Thankfully, we do not do this work alone, but with the continual love and strength of God pouring over us, with the support of our brothers and sisters in Christ, with all of God's promises holding us up, and all of God's people to lean on. And we are sent out to be that compassion and help for others, gifted, strengthened, and given Jesus power and authority through the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Let's get out into the world, and let's live out that call. May it be so.
Let us pray for the mending of God's world.
God, you send your church as laborers into your harvest. Heal our divisions and unite us in mission. Make us one at your table. Faithful Creator, protect your earth and breathe life into its future. Stir our hearts to compassion, that we become healers for the sake of your whole creation, as it is made new. Hear us, O God. Holy One, you desire peace for all nations. Give rulers and citizens wisdom in the use of power, that wars may cease and all who suffer exile, hunger, and terror find safe haven. Passionate One, you have brought us to yourself. Stay near to all who suffer broken hearts, fearful spirits, and disruptive illness. We pray for those with specific needs, including those we now say aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Bring healing and hope to your people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Abba, Father, your love for your children is boundless. Bless all who Father among us and all who yearn for a protective Father. Grant wisdom, patience, and good humor. Thank you for those who have shown us fatherly care, living God, all who live and all who die belong to you. Thank you for all whose lives have witnessed to your glory. Comfort all who mourn. Hear us, O God.
All these things and whatever else you see that we entrust to your care through Jesus our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
same practice for our new liturgy for Holy, Holy, Holy. So in the middle of the prayer, there will be a time where Cheryl will play through it, Jean will sing it, and then we'll all join it together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. Fulfilling the promise of the resurrection, you poured out the fire of your Spirit, uniting in one body people of every nation and tongue. And so with the disciples, with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with the earth and sea and all of their creatures, with the angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Us from evil.
Jesus Christ, this meal, who have given us not only this bread and cup, but your very self, that we may feast on your great love. Filled again by these signs of your grace, may we hunger for your reign of justice. May we thirst for your way of peace. For you are Lord of forevermore. Amen.
May God, who has brought us from death to life, fill you with great joy. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.